Welcome back on our 20th anniversary show. Let's meet the future. Andrew Leigh joined the Labor Party as a teenager. By 32 years old, he was a full professor of economics at ANU with a glittering trail of top degrees, including a PhD from Harvard. He came into Parliament at the last election in the Canberra-based seat of Fraser. Now, 1 year older, Josh Frydenberg holds higher degrees from both Harvard and Oxford universities before he entered Parliament in 2010 in Robert Menzies' old seat of Kooyong in Melbourne. Josh Frydenberg was Director of Global Banking for Deutsche Bank and an advisor to both Foreign Minister Alexander Downer and former Prime Minister John Howard. Now, to grill them, I'm temporarily luring Mrs. Schubert out of her recent press gallery retirement. Misha, good morning to you.
Good morning.
Gentlemen, you both went to Harvard, you both got degrees from there. You are similar in so many ways, age and outlook on many things. So, let me start. Why Labor?
Well, Hugh, I think there's two things that mark out modern Labor to me. The first is the commitment to egalitarianism, to caring deeply about poverty and inequality. But the second is a commitment to liberalism, to open markets, to protection of minorities, a tradition that goes all the way back to Alfred Deakin, but I think is increasingly a tradition that Labor can grab with both hands.
OK. Why the Liberal Party, Josh?
Look, the philosophy and the values that the Liberal Party represents are the ones that I also share, and that's a belief in the individual, the power of free enterprise, the role of limited government, not too big a government. I mean, at the end of the day, what separates Andrew and I, or Labor and Liberal, is that we believe in equality of opportunity, not equality of outcomes.
What do you dislike most about each other's political traditions, philosophically speaking?
Well, I think that the union movement, Misha, has had too big a say in the Labor Party and its politics, organised labour. There's a role for organised labour, but not to dictate the policies of one particular political party. And we've seen that play out now with the punishing situation for small business and for big business as unions are in control of Labor Party's policy.
Is that the critical difference, do you think?
I'm actually enormously proud to be part of a party which was formed out of the union movement, Hugh, and Alfred Deakin was pretty proud of unions as well. But for me, on the other side, it's the negativity, that phrase that was once used in US politics, the nattering nabobs of negativity, that sense that the role of an opposition is not to create but to destroy, to attack. That, I think, drags down Australian politics. It's not always something you see on Josh's side of politics, but I do feel as though it's on the rise at present.
OK, well, let's be positive. We're taking a 20-year view of the future. Josh, what would you want to do? What contribution would you want to make to change Australia in a particular way? What needs to be done? What would you do towards that end?
Well, one of the areas I'm really interested in is foreign policy and seeing Australia more deeply engage in Asia, and it's quite timely because today we're going to see the Asian Century White Paper. So one of the things I really want to focus on is how Australia can capitalise on the massive transformation, Hugh, taking place in our region. 1.3 billion people in India.
But Labor's into that too, so what's different and what are you going to do with this?
OK, well, what has happened, unfortunately, under the foreign policy of the Labor government is that our bilateral relationships with key partners, be it Indonesia, be it Japan, even China and India, have faltered under the last few years. For example, the last prime ministerial visit to Beijing we've only had one prime ministerial visit to Beijing since 2008. With India, the prime minister has just been there, but she didn't go there for 2 years. With Japan, we pulled out of the quadrilateral security dialogue and upset our Japanese counterparts. And with Indonesia, we're all aware of what happened with the cancellation of live animal exports and what that's done to our bilateral relationship. So, personally, Hugh, I think there are lots of areas where we can improve our foreign policy in the region.
And Andrew, the same question to you. What's the big challenge, do you think, for the nation in the next 20 years, and what would you like to see us do to meet that challenge?
So, Misha, there's two things that keep me awake at night. One is this drop in Australian test scores, the drop we saw from 2000 to 2009. I think we need to turn that around, and I think that's actually the key in terms of Australia in the Asian century. We will best make use of the opportunities of the rise of Asia if we have terrifically well-educated youngsters. And the other is boosting entrepreneurship. We have very low patenting rates in Australia, and I'd really like to see those rise. So I share Josh's views on Asia. I grew up as a kid in Aceh, Jakarta and Sarawak. And so I think being more engaged in those regions is absolutely vital.
OK, for one heady minute there when you mentioned test scores, I thought we were going to get onto the cricket, but we'll take a break instead. We'll be back with our guests in just a moment. Some anguish this last week, of course, after the media were tipped off ahead of the police raid on the home of MP Craig Thompson. Perhaps the laws of karma were at work as Mr. Thompson's wife, Zoe, headed off in the family wagon a short time later.